Well, okay. Very good. It's good to see you all this morning.
Woo!
Woo! Yeah. So, yeah. You know, I heard a story. My man. Okay. Speaking of school season and so on, you know, a teacher walks into a bar and says, "Can I have a drink?" And the bartender says, "I don't know, can you?" Wow. That was appropriate for today. Come on. This guy's wounded, obviously. Like, grammar got him. Grammar police arrested him many times. It's "may I," right? Yeah. Grammar is the most serious of our problems these days, right? Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to get started here for real. We're starting a new series today. I'm excited about this one. It's called DNA, and Michelle does an amazing job on these, doesn't she? Like, doesn't that look super dope? Like, you know, you got the cross over here, but like, I like at the beginning where we'll wait for the loop to start. Come on now. Come on. Wow, that's really long. Okay, see, it's chaos, but then boom. It's brought into order. What's up? From the chaos of like endless choices, there's order and focus that's brought. DNA is what makes us unique. It tells our body, blonde or brunette, green or blue eyes. DNA is the programming that essentially informs our bodies what to do and how we look and so on. And so we're going to look at the DNA of Creekside for the next few weeks. There's some amazing churches in this community, and you know, we bless them, and they're doing, as long as they cling to the cross and the word with authority, we bless them and just pray for them. But there's, you know, if you go and if you've ever been church shopping before, right? Maybe you moved to a new area, or the pastor said something you didn't like, and you moved down the street to the— No, you wouldn't do that. But you move to a different area. We'll stick with that one. And you just kind of want to find a church. What feels like home? Well, we can't control what feels like home to people. We want to be welcoming. We want to be friendly and so on. But what informs the millions of choices and millions of priorities that we could focus on? What informs our choices? Because there's only so much time, only so much resource, only so many things that we can focus on. So our DNA helps bring those things into focus. We call those things our core values. And so, you know, you've heard me talk about things like making this a safe place for kids and how we run backup checks on anybody who comes into contact with kids here. And you know, any kind of nonsense, any kind of sketchy stuff, not going to even bother with it. It's not going to happen. This is going to be a safe place for kids. That's not actually one of our core values. That's just something that we say is a priority. But we are going to be looking at a few statements that we have that are core values. So to start with, you know, the word church has really kind of become just a word that's lost its original meaning. You know, church is not really used in the Bible. It's not a Greek word. It's actually from an old German word. Kirche, which meant the building. It was always a reference to the building where the Christians would go to worship, to focus on the word, to fellowship, to be equipped. Kirche always meant the building. But what's happened today is that the word church has become the word that we use to sort of, it's just stuck. We just call it the building. But in the Bible, you know, there's a word called ecclesia, which the Bible refers to as the church, which what we would say is the church, because the church is the people. You know, okay, it's kind of like this. When you say at home, "Hey, I need a Kleenex," what you're really doing is saying, "I need a facial tissue," but the word, the brand, the company, Kleenex, has become the word that we use for the facial tissue. See what I'm saying? So we use the word church, and we started talking about the building. I'm going to the church. And it just became easy, and rather than tripping over our words, you know, the place where we go together, you know, we just say the church. But the church is the people. Okay? Biblically, the church is ecclesia, and it's called, it literally means the called out ones. And so we have to kind of ask the question, called out for what? Now, certainly, gathering together to worship and to pray is a priority. By the way, I don't know if you know this, we gather together to worship and pray every Tuesday night here. There's a little commercial for you. But tell me, you know, what did the first called out ones, the disciples, do? What did the first called out ones do? Because it wasn't talking about a building. And so what did they do? Well, the first called out ones, they followed Jesus as he went around preaching the kingdom of God, demonstrating its power by delivering people from sickness and demons and calling people to repentance and faith in Christ. And so the first church called out ones had nothing to do with a building, and everything that happened that was power and preaching and sharing the gospel happened outside of a building. Now, you did see where regularly Jesus was in the temple teaching, in the synagogues teaching, but the majority of the time it was outside the walls of any particular building. And so in Luke 10, they even are sent out on their own to do the same thing that Jesus was doing in his name. But there was always a home base for them to come back to. There was always a place to come back to gather, to be strengthened. And so, like I said, you find Jesus in the temple or teaching in the synagogue on the Sabbath, and you also find this pattern. I'm saying this because people today say, oh, no, you don't need the church. I don't need to go to church to be a Christian. Well, technically you're right, but also technically you're stupid. Did I say it? I'm probably going to get in trouble today, but we need the church. We need the gathering of the church, the called out ones, so we can be strengthened, especially in the days that we're living in. And so you see a lot of ministry happening outside of the buildings that were of the worship. I'm just going to say church, but you know by now I'm talking about you know, the difference between building and the people. But you also find in the pattern of Paul's ministry to the Gentiles, he would go to a new place, start preaching to the Jewish population, to the Jews first and then the Gentiles. And I had somebody recently ask me, like, what's up with that? You know, that doesn't seem fair. Well, it's not about value, it's about priority, because the Jews were the ones that received the covenant, the law, they were God's chosen people. And the Gentiles, as we respond in faith to Jesus, the Jewish Messiah, we are grafted into that vine where we are the recipients of those promises. So Paul started with the Jews, and then outside the synagogue walls would go and preach to the crowds. He preached to the rest of the congregation. So why talk about all this? So we have the gathering of the saints, and by saints, that's every Christian believer who has been reborn by the Spirit of God. It's not a special class of believer. It's not, you don't need a statue to be a saint. It's everyone who's been redeemed by God. And so the gathering of the saints to worship, to pray, to receive and give God's word, and to receive and give the ministry of the Holy Spirit, all of that is essential. But if we're in the, as we come to the home base to be strengthened and encouraged, but if we're really going to be followers of Jesus, we're called to go out and be the church, the called out ones, in the community. That's a great spot to aim in if you have just a half a second to give a little bit of voice to something like that. Whew. Amen. Okay, I got to take a rest. That was a rough one. We come together, we gather together as we should, whether it's raining or snowing, whether it's hot or cold, we should come together weekly because, number one, we get to. Gosh, I watched a video about what's going on in the underground church in China recently. I'm like, dear God, they come together for, they travel hundreds of miles in secret and sit in a 120-degree room, literally, for 12 hours. And just the leaders in that room, they share memorized scripture, because in prison they have to memorize it real quick because their Bibles get taken away. And just the people in a small room, the pastor who was there meeting in secret with them was asked, how many people do you represent? And they said, let's see, about 15 million. I'm like, dear Lord, we get people that make the decision to go to church based on how they feel Saturday night or Sunday morning. And if it's more than 15 minutes, whew, gas is expensive. I don't know. We get to gather. Do we need to have our rights to gather taken away so that we appreciate gathering? I'm just saying some words up here. I don't know. So to be true followers of Jesus, it isn't about you or what you believe. Those are important. It's not even about coming to church regularly, which is important. It's actually critical. It's also about being a person that follows Jesus outside the walls, who is looking for opportunities to share Christ. Because you've made it. Hallelujah, you've made it. You're going to be in heaven forever rejoicing. That's awesome. But it ain't just about you. You need to talk to people about Jesus. And I know that scares you. But what if, right? The what if parade starts. What if I don't have the answer? What if they hate me? What if they reject me? What if I say the wrong thing and then they hate Jesus forever because I said the wrong thing? What? Jesus will meet you by his Spirit in those moments and give you the words to say. And even if it comes out like, he will translate that somehow to their hearts and be like, yo, I don't know what that guy was saying, but I felt something going on there. As we draw near to Creekside Palooza next month, we're going to focus on our core values. You know, we have some new folks that have started attending in the last year or so. Since then, we love you. We're glad you're part of the family. So there's new folks that need to hear about it, but also we need to reinforce why we do what we do. You know, church can mean a lot of different things. It's a blessing and not a sign of division, as most critics say, to have many different flavors or denominations of churches. That's a blessing. As long as they hold to the authority of Scripture and the cross of Jesus Christ, it's a blessing. It's good. You know, Creekside is unique, but different flavors are also good. I'm not sure what flavor we are yet, but there are definitely a whole lot of nuts in it. Chief one right here, right? And so, you know, we're building something here, and I don't know if you know that, because we're getting, just in general, this world has gone mad. We're getting beat up, like all kinds of images and information just hitting us all the time. And so things are rough, recession, income, job loss, different, all the different things, and then the new wave of the latest fad of pandemic is coming down the pike, that's great. And so I know that it's maybe harder than ever, but that's okay, because God will be sufficient. His grace is sufficient, because his strength is made perfect in our weakness. And so we're building something here, but there's also the understanding that unless the Lord builds the house, we labor in vain. But that doesn't mean that we're called to passivity and just sit. We're aiming for something specific. And God is a God of strategy. If you don't know that, you haven't really read the Bible through. But God is a God of strategy. When you start in the beginning, you see the plan of salvation already worked out. It took thousands of years to manifest. But God has strategy and is aiming for something. And so, so we aim for things that are specific. Church is not and should not be the same everywhere. For example, we're in Iowa in the United States. If we tried to build an African apostolic model of church like in Tanzania, it would fail because we're not there. We're here. And so it's absurd to try and copy something that works in a totally different situation. We bless that, and that's great, but that's not here. And this is 2022. It is not even 2019. We're living in a whole different world. If we tried to build a church on the 1970s model, it would fail. If we tried to build a church on the pre-2020 model, it would fail. The church adapts. The church changes. What is the church again? Oh, you're listening. That's good. You see, the church is a living thing. It's not a static thing. It's not a building. It's a living thing. It's an organism, not an organization. But that doesn't mean it's a free-for-all either. It's not chaos. God is a God of order, and so is his kingdom. So we don't try to do everything or be everything or chase everyone. We focus our efforts, our time, our energy on what God is calling us to do. And the body of Christ as a whole, other churches and so on, can focus on all the other different things, but we're going to focus on what God has called us to do. Excuse me. So, listen, do you know how to live a life by mission rather than feelings? Do you have something that narrows your focus and allows you to put up boundaries, allows you to say no to good things because you're focused on the God thing? Do you know how to do that? That's what we're trying to do as a church. You know, our core values are about this. If we focus on these things for this chapter of the church's story, then God will meet us, use us, and move us forward. Okay, so the first value today I want to talk about is found people, find people. That's right. You've heard this before. This is good. So why don't you stand with me? We're going to read some scripture together. And we just do that to honor God's word as we look at it together. We'll be in the New Living Translation version of the Bible. You have your paper Bibles. They just started making these things. They're amazing. Paper Bibles. It's like there's gold on the thing. Amazing. Or you could open up your apps and whatever, but we'll also have the cheat on the screen for you. I just like for people to engage with the word that they're going to be reading at home apart from church, so there's a familiarity with it for them. But anyway, Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. When Jesus returned again to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. Soon the house where he was staying was so packed with visitors that there was no room even outside the door. Yeah, we need some of that around here. While he was preaching God's word to them, four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. They couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, so they dug a hole through the roof above his head. Then they lowered the man on his mat right down in front of Jesus. Seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, "My child, your sins are forgiven." But the religious folks who were sitting around got mad. But some of the teachers of the religious law who were sitting there thought to themselves, "What does he say? This is blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins." And they were right. Only God can forgive sins. Jesus, God the Son. You see where I'm going with that? Okay, anyway, verse 8. Jesus knew immediately what they were thinking, so he asked them, "Why do you question this in your hearts? Is it easier to say to the paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or 'Stand up, pick up your mat, and walk'? So I will prove to you that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins." Who is the only one who has authority to forgive sins? God. So he is confirming and affirming the divinity that he is fully God and fully man. And I say that because there's some core Christian beliefs that are under attack. I've seen lots of different videos and debates, and one of them is the divinity of Jesus. So I want you to cling to the truth that you know. Okay, these are old arguments that are coming back again. Anyway, so then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, "Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home." And the man jumped up. He didn't just stand up. He jumped up, grabbed his mat, and walked out through the stunned onlookers. They were all amazed and praised God, exclaiming, "We've never seen anything like this before. This is amazing." We need some of that. Lord, let's pray. Father, I pray you bring us Jesus in this house. Jesus, I just pray by your Spirit that you would come in this room. You walk up and down every aisle. Lord, that you would touch every person in this place. We prayed over every single seat in this house that you would speak something to them this morning, as we do every week. And so, Lord, I'm asking that you come by your Spirit, walk in this house. I pray, Father, that you take us, that you bless us, that you break us, and that you give us. Take us, Lord. Use us for your purposes. Help us, God, to follow you in these times. That's in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Verse 3. Four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. So we don't know the relationship of these four men to the paralytic, but we do know that they made an effort to get this man to Jesus. Now, whether he was a friend, a relative, we just don't know. But Jesus says that when he saw the faith of these four men, not the paralytic, he forgave, he acted, he healed. I want you to think about that for a moment. When he saw the faith of the four men, we'll just say they're friends. When he saw the faith of the four friends bringing this man to Jesus, he acted. Sometimes you come to God or you're afraid to come to God. I don't know if I believe. I don't know if I just. But what if we surrounded people that we know with faith and belief and brought them to Jesus, and then Jesus acts upon our faith and he heals and he forgives? Of course, every person needs to place their trust in Jesus as Lord and Savior for themselves, but God can do a work even if the person doesn't have enough faith for it. Yeah, okay. So these four men heard that Jesus was in the house. A bunch of other people had heard that already and had already showed up. And so these four were late. Why? Why were these four people late to church? It wasn't because they got up late. It wasn't because it was raining or they stayed out too late. They were late to church because they had a stop to make before getting to church. These four men didn't go to church to just attend. They were bringing somebody to Jesus. Does anybody see maybe where I'm going? Okay, listen, if you need it, you have the pastor's permission to be late to church. If you're stopping to go pick somebody up and bring them here, it's all good. And so these four men heard where Jesus was and what he had been doing in ministry, and then something, I've heard his words, I saw him, and I've seen what he's been doing. He's been healing people, setting people free. And so with their faith and what they saw and heard, they also immediately took the next step in their brains and hearts to think about their friend who could really use what Jesus was giving out. Is your faith all about you? Are you a narcissist? Are you self-centered? Jesus, gimme, 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 and you're always consuming, but you're never giving out. So they heard where Jesus was at, what he'd been doing in his ministry. They thought of their friend, and we're going to call him Matt. I mean, it got a little tense there for a second. I had to lighten it up a little bit. But we can infer that these four men had heard about Jesus. We can infer that due to what they experienced, that faith had welled up within them and they became believers. And so how can we make such an inference? Because no one goes through the effort to haul a grown man through a crowd up some stairs. That's how they got to the roof and the Middle East times, there was a stairway up on the side of the house to go up to a flattened roof on top where they would store things. And so they could go up there, and it was made of straw and mud and different things. And so nobody goes through the effort to drag a grown man through a crowd, up some stairs, dig through a roof, risk a riot, risk a fence, and lower a man down in front of somebody that they had come to believe in. They were risking a lot. What if Jesus gets mad? We've placed our trust in him. What if he reacts negatively to this? I don't know, but Matt really needs a miracle, and so maybe we can just risk it. So in verse 4, they couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, so they dug a hole through the roof above his head. Then they lowered the man on his mat right down in front of Jesus. You know, around here, if we need a hole in the roof, we simply send Diane or Merle up to the third floor, and things just kind of happen. Too bad Diane wasn't in here. Yeah, she'll get me. But here's the thing with this roof. There's a real-world issue here, right, of someone damaging a roof. Like, we read it in the Bible, we know what happens, and it's all amazing, but we don't really put ourselves in the story a lot of times. But somebody damaged a roof, and most people believe it was Peter's home. But after the meeting, after the crowd had left, you know someone might be looking at the hole in the roof and wondering, well, who's going to fix that? Who's going to clean up the dust and the debris? I mean, what's up with that? Or would they? You know, if there was a Karen around, not you, Karen. This Karen's very sweet, but we're not talking about her. But you know what I'm saying. If there was a Karen around, all that she would see is the mess instead of the miracle. It doesn't matter that somebody got healed. Doesn't matter that someone's eternal destination was changed because they found forgiveness and mercy with Jesus. All they would see is the mess and not the miracle. We know that the religious Karens were upset. Verse 6, but some of the teachers of the religious law who were sitting there thought to themselves, what is he saying? You know, how many churches miss the miracle because they're afraid of a little mess? How many would gladly clean up a mess or fix a hole if it meant that Jesus was doing miracles in the house? Guess what? He is, and there is. He is doing miracles, and there is some mess. In the last 2 years, we've seen dozens of people respond to faith to trust Jesus as their Savior. That's a miracle each and every time. That's the most important miracle that there is. Doesn't mean I'm satisfied. Are you? We've seen close to 20 people baptized in water, several healed, several baptized in the Holy Spirit. Miracles every time. And with that, there have been some messes that needed cleaned up. There are inconveniences that have happened. There are some Karens, male and female, that got their panties in a twist. Wait, can I say that? Somebody check the rule book. Can I say that? I guess it's out there. So, you know, Here's the thing, people. We can have a perfectly pristine building where all we do is focus on fixing what breaks and replacing the siding every time the wind blows. If we choose to do nothing, we can have a very pristine building. We can talk to no one. We can do nothing. We can just show up and sing everybody's preferred songs. And maybe give a little sermonette that makes people feel, oh, I feel special, I feel good. Rainbows, unicorns, sunshine. We can have a perfectly behaved pastor. I don't know what that's about. I don't know what that reaction is. I'm going to start over. We can have a perfectly behaved pastor who says nothing that challenges anyone, nothing that confronts, says nothing really meaningful at all, and only talks to people about being good people, do religious things, and then we would have absolutely no impact for the kingdom of God, be completely ignored by the devil, and then quietly close the doors of the church forever in a few years because we wanted things easy. Just like the old days. Yeah, the old days weren't that great either, were they? So I'm here to present to you an alternative today. What if we rolled our sleeves up, embraced inconvenience, embraced hard work, embraced sacrifice, sacrificial giving, sacrificial service, sacrificial loving, loving the unlovable. You know, what if we did that? What would that look like? I think that we might see some more miracles if we did that. If we stay focused. You know, in the Bible, it says that they dug through the roof, but in the Greek, this word only is used here in the whole New Testament. It's a rare word. And basically, literally, it says they unroofed the roof. They unroofed the roof. And so, beyond just the physical removal of a roof and the physical mess, there was something happening here that I believe that God is saying to us. There was something happening in the Spirit here. You see, unroofing the roof means removing any and all obstacles for somebody to get to Jesus. There was an obstacle preventing somebody from their miracle, and the obstacle was removed. And it wasn't by God, was it? There are some things God will not do for you because He's called you to do them. And so they removed the obstacle keeping Matt from Jesus. They unroofed the roof. It means removing limitations. It means finding new ways. It means breaking through barriers. It means crashing through old ways of thinking that keep people of this day and age from getting to Jesus. It means taking leaps of faith that seem absurd in the short term, but God will come through. This needs to be in our DNA here at Creekside, that we are going to be the called out ones that Jesus can rely upon, not to get lazy, not to get self-centered, not to turn into religious Karens, but will instead look around every day and ask, who can I carry to Jesus today? These four men, do you think that they were the local mat carrying guild? Do you think that they had little red lights spinning on the edge at the four corners of the mat? They were just looking for somebody, like they're the local EMS squad in Jerusalem or Capernaum, actually. You know, I think that they just heard Jesus. I think they believed on Him. I think they knew that Jesus heals people and sets them free, and I think that they thought of a person in their life that could use that. You know, I know when I tell people to talk to somebody about Jesus, a lot of people say, I'm not qualified. I need a class. I need a course. I need training. No, you don't. No, you don't. Absolutely not. In fact, I've found that the more we teach people how to do these things, the less effective they are. Just tell your story. Just tell your story. I mean, you think a backwards hillbilly shepherd knew anything about being a warrior or a king, but God saw David. He was the least, he was the runt of the house, but God saw him, least qualified in everybody's eyes. You don't need that. You don't need a resume for this. You think a ragtag collection of 12 men from all different kinds of viewpoints and personalities knew anything about being a transformational force in this world? Do you think they went to conferences and had courses and degrees about how to change the world in 6 weeks? They were just regular men that God used. Oh, I know that those are people from the Bible, and like we tend to kind of not look at them as real people. Well, let me tell you about a man named Desmond Doss, a real person. They're all real, but a more recent example. Desmond Doss was a super skinny vegetarian pacifist. And he was a war hero in the Second World War. But he's definitely not the typical picture of manhood or hero material. But when Japan attacked Pearl Harbor, Desmond Doss signed up because he felt like he needed to do something for God and his country. So a pacifist joined the military to do something. It just felt like he had to do something. And my God, if we would just pay attention to that little urge in us, like, to just do something. Start somewhere. But the interesting thing is he retained his convictions of being a pacifist. He refused to carry a gun all the way through basic training and all the way onto the battlefield. He took a lot of heat. They tried to kick him out. They called him a coward. Could you imagine being in the army and refusing to carry a gun, a weapon, any kind? But at the Battle of Okinawa, his unit faced terrible odds and terrible geography. Out of 155 men, only 55 got out of the trap that was waiting for them on their own. But see, Desmond was a medic, and he refused to retreat until he rescued the rest of his men. The same ones that mistreated him, the same ones that called him coward, the same ones that put him down. He says this. He says, the bullets were flying, and I just grabbed them by the collar and got as close to the ground as possible. And I was praying, please, Lord, help me get just one more. And once I had got him, I said it all over again. And so after dragging them from the battlefield, he tied a rope around himself to lower each injured comrade down the cliff to safety. He continued this for hours. A skinny pacifist vegetarian. He continued for hours until everyone was rescued. And only then, at the end, did he climb down himself, miraculously free from serious injury. Desmond Doss was the first conscientious objector, although he says conscientious cooperator, to receive the U.S. Medal of Honor. And so, I don't want to just tell the story, I want to show it. So if we could dim the house lights here, we have a video clip that we're going to show you and about this moment. Thank you.
see.
Be quiet.
Just be quiet. Hold still now. Ooh. I got you. Hold tight. There you go. Try now.
I thought it was blind.
Shh. Keep it down. Can you walk?
Hello?
We gotta get out of here. Okay. Come on.
We got you. We got you.
So his prayer was, please, Lord, help me get one more. And it didn't show the attacks of the enemy in the clip, and his life was in danger the whole time. So I just kind of wonder, and I thought about this, and I thought about our scripture for today. And so I just kind of wondered, what would that feel like? So, you know, I went and got some food that we're going to put in our pantry, and but I got 150 pounds here, that about the average weight of men, average, certainly not my weight, but what would that feel like for hours, dragging in rough terrain, and what was his purpose? Please, Lord, save just one more. And so I wondered, like, why do we do Palooza? Why do we push through? And even today, coming to church, there's several people here that had to do some real battles just to be here. Why do we do that? Please, Lord, just one more. It's inconvenient. It's hard work. We could be doing a lot of other things. But if Jesus really is who he said he is, and if his words are really true in what he said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I wonder if we can manage a little bit of sacrifice and a little bit of inconvenience to bring people to Jesus. Just one more. Eric, who do you think you are talking like that? Offending me. Who do you think you are? I'm no one. Just trying to get one more. Why do I challenge? Why do I preach? I don't need the spotlight. Just one more. If Jesus is coming back soon, just one more. Just one more. And so we celebrate each and every one. We can applaud and thank God for what He's doing for each and every one. But how many are still back there? And how many of us are content to sit comfortably in padded seats and air conditioning and watch other people do the work, while we sit back and tell them how they could have done it better? Oh, God hasn't called me to be an evangelist. He's called everybody to be an evangelist. And so, we keep at the work. We're tired. Hey, Pastor, giving's down, and inflation is up, and costs are up, and we had a negative financial month again. Have faith. We got to keep working. God will provide, won't He? And so we keep working. Because God's going to give faith where faith is needed to those that ask and those that can focus and see. He's going to provide as we align with His purposes. One more. Anybody have some unsaved loved ones or friends that need Jesus? How serious can you get in prayer and efforts? I'm praying that as we approach Creekside Palooza, that's just an event. I want this to be in our DNA 12 months a year. But I pray that God drops maybe 5 names in your heart where you can be praying for them as we approach harvest season. One more. Now, what if I had a few men to help me carry this load? Anyone? Yes, you are. You're acting like it, so you are. So Locke walks like one, talks like one. We're going to share the load. Isn't that something? That looked a little easier. One more. Is it worth it just for one more? Is it? Because you have to have an eternal perspective to know that it's worth it for one more. One more. One more person saved. One more person healed. One more person come to know Jesus. Is it worth it? I know we work hard. I mean, we had some rest in the summer, and that's all good. But is it worth it for one more? And think about how he did that for hours. 75 different ones. Thank you, gentlemen. You can be seated. And I don't know if you noticed in the clip, the video clip that we showed, but the first guy he was trying to save shot at him. Did you notice that? Because he couldn't see. He was blind. You might get attacked for trying to save and help somebody. You okay with that? Because when they come to see Jesus, when they come to meet Jesus, I once was blind, but now I see. Oh, I want to thank you for not letting me run you off, not letting me discourage you. You kept after me week after week, month after month. And because of you, I'm going to spend eternity with Jesus. So this needs to get in our DNA, because what this church is not, it's not a Christian retirement community. It's not a museum dedicated to the good old days. It's not a monastery disengaged from the world around us. This is a boot camp and sometimes a battleground. This is war. This is the church. This is the ecclesia, the ones who are called out of the world unto salvation. The ones that the Lord looks to share the good news, share the testimony, share in his mission. Can God use you? Absolutely. Just look around each day. Ask the Lord to use you, to put you in the path of somebody who needs to hear. Tell somebody about Jesus this week. Time is short. So why do we do Creekside Palooza? I mean, it's not like a big evangelistic event. We're just trying to build relationship with people and give a gift to our community. But why do we do that? Why do we shape things the way that we do? Why do we make this a place where people can invite friends and family that are far from God? Because found people find people. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. That Lord, personally, I thank you that you didn't give up on me. I was the biggest hypocrite. You kept after me. You chased me. You gave me grace and mercy when I deserved judgment and separation. I thank you for that, Lord. Lord, there are many people wounded, many people far from you today. But God, I believe that you're still calling people, and I believe that you're going to do miracles. I believe that you're going to use us, even as unqualified as we are, as unpolished as we are. God, you're going to use us to make an eternal difference in this community. God, I'm asking right now, supernaturally, for the provision, the financial provision, to do this outreach and to do the other outreaches that we do in this community. God, you are our source. And so, Lord, I'm asking for miracles in the name of Jesus that you would provide, as you always do. We ask in his faith. And God, I'm asking, God, for you to just set appointments, divine appointments for people here today, this week, that they would come into contact with people that need to hear about you, or at minimum, receive an invite to church and to Creekside Palooza. Use us, God. For your glory, for your purposes. Help us, Lord, even if it's just for one more. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Doing it, but I'm also going to just ask, are we still live streaming? Good. So I'm going to say this. Maybe you're here in the service Maybe you're watching online. I just feel like God kind of put this on me to do it. I'm going to feel really televangelisty, and I don't like that. But here's the deal. If you're here, you're watching online, whether it's live or the recorded thing later, I'm going to ask somebody to have some faith and sow a seed. Times are tough for everybody. We're a church. We exist based on what people give. And so costs are up for us just like they are for you. Summer is always a little bit of a struggle. People take their tithes with them on vacation or something. this is something that we want to do to the community. We feel like it's important. So we're going to go ahead. But I'm asking you to pray. And if somebody wants to sow into some good ground, ask God and send it in.